Just going to give it a couple of minutes.
Sure, sure. How did you get into doing what you do, Samantha?
Interesting. So I was in corporate, you know, strategy roles in, and I spent the last 10 plus years in Singapore. That was my fault. I spent the last 10 plus years in Singapore, and then I just wanted to take a break from corporate careers. And we moved as a family to Kodi. And it's been a very welcome change, I must say.
So when you say we moved as a family, do your kids go to the school as well?
Not yet. I've got a 3-year-old. So not yet ready for school, but hopefully next year. Okay, that was my phone causing a bit of an interruption.
You hear more of an echo with the phone. I always admire people who can make such choices. And like Sita on this side of the Lakshman Rekha, I always hesitate to cross that. Okay, I am sure I'm not only Sita there. There are many, many who are enamored by a life like the one that you lead and hesitate.
Cool. That was my phone. Okay, just too many things ringing. I think it was Stephanie actually trying to log in. 2 minutes in, I think we should, should we start off, Amin?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to today's session. I'm really pleased and honored to be introducing Mr. Amin Haq to all of you. Before we start, just a little bit about this session, which is titled Grace Stories Happen to Those Who Can Tell Them. Irrespective of which path in life you're in, whether you're a student, you're a parent, you're a middle schooler, or you're a high schooler, I'm pretty sure all of you are thinking of stories that you want to tell either to your companies, to your friends, or for the colleges that you're applying for. No doubt, storytelling is going to be one of the critical skills that is going to differentiate all of us in the days and years to come. And to help us understand what storytelling is and how we can get better at it, we have Mr. Amin with us. Amin says he's refused to grow up and he remains a child, not just by heart, but also in every other way. He's a story coach who's helped several CEOs, startup founders, innovators, teachers, and parents discover the power of storytelling and to become better storytellers. Without further ado, I'd like to invite Amin to our virtual stage. Over to you, Amin.
Thank you so much. And, you know, I'm really delighted to be here. I was told KIS is one of the oldest or the oldest international schools in India. And it's a pleasure and an honor to be here amidst your company and to share what I have learned about storytelling with you. So let me share my slides with you and take you through a very short journey into the world of storytelling. Think of this as a conversation and really like to have a conversation with all of you guys here. So let's talk through this. And when I say talk, feel free to respond to me on the chat window. Feel free to unmute yourself and speak or ask questions. With that, let me begin with a confession. I am not an expert in storytelling. It would be the biggest fake story in the world to believe for ourselves that we are experts in anything. A lifetime is not enough to learn something. And there's a lot more that I need to learn about storytelling myself. But someone said this to me, that if you want to learn something, try teaching it and you may end up learning it faster. So I try to teach storytelling so that I can learn it faster for myself. Now, when I was a child and when I was in school, I used to be extremely shy and reserved, and I was an introvert. There's no right or wrong. There are all kinds of colors in the rainbow, and all of them make the rainbow what it is. However, my mother was very anxious for me, and out of deep concern and anxiety for me, she enrolled me into speech therapy, into elocution and debate competitions, into poetry recitation, into the dramatic society and theater, and all the extra co-curricular activities that she could think of. Think of it as comprehensive damage control strategy. I hated it. And when I look back now, I am very grateful to her for all of these, because all of these things helped me a lot. My first role in a theater production was to play a dead body. It's not an easy one to pull off. Try lying flat on a stage for 1 hour. And mind you, there are flies and mosquitoes buzzing around all the time, and you can't even move your hands. My second role in a school production was to play a sentry, a guard. I had to stand in front of the audience for 1 hour, and I had one word to say in the entire play: attention. Eventually, I got around to doing better parts, and I directed my first play when I was in class 10th. Theater, was a lifelong and has been a lifelong love affair since then. When I started working, I did a course in advertising, and I started working in advertising. You know, the ads that you interrupt your TV viewing. We were responsible for that in some way. But when I started working in advertising, I started doing theater as well. So my days were spent in office doing advertising. In the evenings, I would go into theater, and both of them deal with stories. Both of them deal with narratives. And I realized that stories are very powerful, but we don't leverage that power in our everyday work as much as we can. I also realized that no matter which business we get into, and when I say business, it could be the change-making business, it could be the NGO work. I use the word business in the original sense of the word, busyness. So no matter which stream of work we get into, the moment you are in business, you are all also in the storytelling business. And good stories happen to those who can tell them. So with that, let's dive into an exercise. I'd like to keep this, like I said, like a conversation or like a workshop. So it's an exercise. In this exercise, I'd like you to be story detectives. So put on your story detective hat and let's go on a journey where I am asking you a question. I'm going to play a video for you. In this video, you will see that someone is trying to tell a story, but that person is not able to influence the audience. The story doesn't work, or doesn't work as well as it could. And then he gets some help. Somebody comes and changes the slide. And once the PowerPoint changes, the story works beautifully. So look at this video as a before and after situation. And tell me on the chat window, what makes the story works better? So I'm really looking forward to your responses. What makes the story work better the second time? There are no right or wrong answers, by the way, because this is subjective. So there can only be correct answers here, your opinions. Shall we dive into this? I am not able to see a yes on the chat window from anyone. Maybe it's because I'm seeing only panelists. All of you can type in into the chat window, and I can see, just type anything so that, you know, just so that I know that you haven't just logged in, but you are really there. Can you type in a yes for me? Anyone? So that I know that there are real people. Ravi Chandran is saying yes. Dr. Alexander is saying yes. Danu is saying yes. Wonderful. Great. So let's dive into this exercise now. Here's the video I want to play for you. Here's the person, and he's, instead of a PowerPoint slide, he's got a cardboard next to him. That's his slide. And in case you have bandwidth issues, I've got screenshots, so don't worry. If you're not able to hear the dialogue, don't worry. It's largely a visual story. Thank you.
saying.
I wrote a saying, but in different words.
Thanks, love.
So let me pause it here. And for those of you who could not see the video properly because of bandwidth issues, let me play the screenshots for you. This is what was written earlier, the before slide. And the lady comes and changes it to something else. So he asked the lady, "What did you do to my sign?" And in response, she says, "I wrote the same. I just used different words." And this is what came up. So you saw the impact of that. Now my question to you, this is an exercise for you and it's a workshop. So what makes the story work better the second time round in your opinion? And it's your opinion, there's no right or wrong, like I said. Would love to hear from you. Looking forward to your answers on the chat window. Why wasn't the story working the first time around? What makes it work better the second time round? Don't take too much time, just go for it. Joanne, I'm looking, yeah. So you say it appeals to the audience, okay. Why wasn't it appealing to the audience in the first place? Here's why it wasn't appealing to the audience. What was he saying? I am blind. Whose story is that? I am blind. Please help is all about me. So where is the audience in that story? Why should the audience care? So what she did was build common ground. People connect much better with the story. Stating the facts wasn't appealing. Invoking contrast helped. You can't see. Wonderful. I love the responses. So let me just build on some of these themes. The first thing a story has to do, friends, is it needs to speak to people's emotions. If it doesn't speak to the heart, it's not a story, it's a fact. And there's a difference between a fact and a story. A story speaks to people's hearts. Now he was giving fact as fact. I am blind, please help. She comes and changes it to an articulation that touches your heart. It's a beautiful day and I can't see it. Yeah, that hits you. Now, some of you may say, emotions? Hey, hold on for a sec, Amin. I work with numbers and data. I am going to get into business. I am going to become an analyst. I am going to do an MBA. How do I speak to people's emotions? Well, let me give you a case study. Let's role play a bit. Let's assume that I have a very large presentation tomorrow and I'm making that presentation to United Nations and it's about poverty and hunger and malnourishment. So, you know, I'm just pulling out some numbers from the top of my head. Suppose I'm saying that 3 out of 10 children in India or the 33% of children, yeah. Let me say that 33% of children in India are malnourished. So I want to present this data. And I want to present this data in a way that makes an impact. I want to influence the decision. I want people to be moved by that so that the right decision can be taken. Now, this is the data I'm presenting. How should I present it? We're going to play something called fastest fingers first. So I want quick responses from you on the chat window. Very quick, without thinking too much. I'm interested in what your instinctive response is. So I'll give you 3 choices, articulation choices. I could say one of these 3. Please guide me, which of these 3 should I use? It's like a MCQ, multiple choice question, right? So the first choice, I can go and say 33% of kids in India are malnourished. My second option is to go and say 3 out of 10 kids in India are malnourished. My third option is to go and say 1 out of every 3 children in India are malnourished. Which choice should I use tomorrow? First, second, or third? Very quick responses is what I'm looking for from you. Wonderful. So I can see that all of you are saying that I should choose the third one. I hope I have answered the question. If you had any doubt in your mind, that stories speak to people's emotions. Because the fact is, all three of these are the same to a computer. But we don't speak to computers, do we? We speak to human beings, and human beings make decisions. Hopefully, that will not change for some time. So, it's not just... that's one part, that stories need to speak to people's emotions. The second part is to move the story from the I story to the we story. I am blind, please help, is all about me. What's in it for the audience? So you may be invited for a TED talk tomorrow. You may be invited to write an application by an Ivy League school or college. Is it all going to be the I story? Or is there something else in it for the other person? So we are guilty a lot of times of being so preoccupied with our story that we forget the listener. But the listener also needs to be invested in the story. And that's why we need to build common ground. Now, when the lady said, it's a beautiful day, she was setting common ground. Because the audience can see it's a beautiful day. It's the blind man who can't see it. But they can see, and once they see that it's a beautiful day, they start nodding in agreement. Now that's important, because once your audience is nodding in agreement, you are in a better place to talk to them about something. So think about this. How do I get my audience to nod in agreement in the first 2 minutes of a conversation? So move the story from a I story to a we story. The third thing that somebody talked about is something really wonderful. Contrast. Now, who talked about that? Saumitra is saying that, you know, invoking contrast helps. Absolutely. Stories are all about contrast, aren't they? Think about, you know, let's step out of this. And let's think about stories in the classical domain, you know, literature, books, the rich versus the poor, the good versus the bad, day versus night. It's all about contrast. So what's the contrast in this story? In this story, the contrast is between the person with the sight versus the person below. Now, this guy was operating from sympathy, but this is a masterstroke in storytelling. She converts that to empathy. This guy was saying, I am screwed, please help. Now what she does is she says, you are lucky. You haven't thought about it, but think about it for a second. Please pause. You've got eyes. You can see. So instead of making you feel pity for the person, she makes you feel grateful for yourself first. And that's the shift from sympathy to empathy. And empathy is an equal relationship. Sympathy works like this, like an outstretched hand. Please help me. Empathy works like this, as an equal. So no matter where you go tomorrow, remember the power of empathy to build a human-to-human connection across hierarchy, across culture. The last thing that I would say is this, that it's not just what we say, but also how we say something that makes a lot of difference. I'm sure you saw that here, and you know this in life as well, that somebody may want to give us feedback, but you know, when you're giving feedback, it's not just what you say, but how you say it, that makes a lot of difference. So to me, a simple definition of storytelling that has helped me in my life, and I offer it to you, is these three words, truth well told. Now, this is a two-part definition. The first part of that definition is truth. Storytelling has to be anchored in truth. Anything that's not truth is not storytelling. That's lying, that's falsehood. I don't call that story, because you know, anything that's not anchored in truth has a very short shelf life. Eventually, you will be found out. So story has to be truth. But see, this guy was telling the truth. Truth alone is not enough. We live in an attention deficit world. We live in a world cluttered with too much data. So your story needs to stand out first so that it can be heard. Otherwise, truth will be drowned out by the data deluge, by the information overload. So we need to shine a spotlight on the truth. And that's where well-told comes in, the articulation, the delivery of that story. That becomes important as well. So when great content meets great delivery, that's a good story. When data meets good presentation, that's a good story. When truth meets well told, that's a good story. Now, if it's just truth, it's not a good story yet. It needs to be articulated well. If it's beautifully articulated, but there's no truth in it, you know what that is called? Fake news. So both of these elements are important. So let me ask you now, as we go forward, you can take a screenshot if you like of these three important elements of storytelling and the definition of storytelling that I have shared with you. Now let's move forward from here. Let's learn, you know, ideally, if we could hire this lady, we would have all gone out and hired this lady and say, hey, why don't you write my college application? But she is not available for hire. Her skills, though, are something that we can all learn. And that's what we are doing here. We are trying to learn those skills just a little bit through this session. So how do we get those skills and make them work for ourselves? As I go into the next segment, I would like to ask you, can you name some good storytellers? Some good storytellers. Who would you consider good storytellers? Just write down the names for me on the chat window. Quick responses. Fastest fingers first. You are not being judged for the kind of responses you give, but you will be judged for being non-responsive. Jeffrey Archer, of course. Fantastic. Obama. Outstanding. Fantastic. Absolutely. I love that, you know, I struggle with the pronunciation of this name, but I love her talk, the TED talk that she gave, The Danger of a Single Story. What an outstanding TED. If you haven't seen it, please go and see that. Yeah. Sudha Murthy. Yeah. I got to tell her story also. So I love her stories. Indra Nui. Fantastic storyteller. Steve Jobs, great storyteller. Gandhi, great storyteller. Nelson Mandela, outstanding storyteller. Richard Branson, the virgin guy, outstanding storyteller. So many of them, actually, countless. Some good teachers. When I close my eyes and think about my favorite subject, I am reminded about my favorite teachers. When I close my eyes and think about the subjects I didn't like, I am also reminded about the teachers I was scared of. So that correlation also works, and some good teachers are fantastic storytellers. Yeah, wonderful. Now, do you think these storytellers are born storytellers or they are hard-working storytellers? That's my second question. Do you think they are born storytellers or they are hard-working storytellers? Or do you think it's a combination of both? A little bit of both. Yeah, a little bit of both. Yeah. Why choose? Why have either or when we can have and? Well, I have come to believe that, yeah, genes is something that we don't control. Birth is the biggest accident of life. We don't control the gender we are born into. Accident of life. We don't control the skin color we are born with. Accident of life. We don't control the economic circumstances of the family that we are born into. Accident of life. We don't control the country we are born into. We don't, but what we do control is the work that we can do after we are born. That's in our control. Yeah, I may desire to be born in Ambani's house, but that's not in my control. But what I can do is I can work hard. So all good, you know, it is a little bit of both, and I agree with you. But it's like saying that all of us are born with the muscles to run marathons. the marathon runners exercise those muscles a bit more. And the same is true of good storytellers. So let me share a very quick example with you. This is Steve Jobs. And Steve Jobs here is not launching the iPhone, but he is launching the MacBook Air. The MacBook Air, the thinnest and the lightest laptop in the world at the time of its launch. And he speaks for 60 seconds. Now put on your detective hats, the story detective hat. And we are going on a journey. We are going to deconstruct this video and see what are the techniques he's using. So I'm going to pause it again and again. And this is just a 60 second clip. So be glued to your screens. Pay very close attention. Let's move forward.
Kind of notebook. It's called the MacBook Air. It's so thin, it even...
Now he just used an adjective to describe the laptop. What adjective he used? Adjectives are descriptive words like tall is an adjective, short is an adjective. Which adjective did he use to describe? Joanne is saying, he said thin. You're absolutely right. So he said, it's so thin. What's so thin? The laptop. Yeah, so thin. Okay. Now, perhaps, what are they launching? The world's thinnest laptop. That means maybe it's 2 centimeters thin or 2 centimeters thick. I think about it. When we buy a laptop, we compare two laptops side by side. We compare them for the processing power. We compare them for capacity. We compare them for weight. And then this feature is called the thickness of the laptop. Let's assume this new laptop is 2 centimeters thick. I can call it 2 centimeters thick or 2 centimeters thin. It doesn't change the fact that it's 2 centimeters, but it changes the perception in the listener's mind. So the first technique, we just talked about this. It's not what we say, but also how we say something. So if I have to give this technique a name, and if I am allowed to brand it, I would call it frame of reference. What is the frame of reference you're using to describe something? Thick or thin? Yeah. And the same can be used in anything. Glass half full, glass half empty. Yeah. There's 20% attrition rate in my organization. Or I can say there's 80% retention in my organization. So how do you, which frame of reference are you working with? Let's go forward. Let's move forward and see what else he does here. Ready, detectives?
Called the MacBook Air. It's so thin, it even fits inside one of these envelopes that we've all seen floating around the office. And
he said something very funny. Did you catch it? He says, it's so thin that it fits into an envelope that you may have seen float around the office. Float around the office? Envelopes don't float around the office unless you have ghosts in your office. Have you seen envelopes floating around the office? Who speaks like that? It's a figure of speech. But you know, if you had to say this, you would say it's so thin that it fits into an envelope that you may have seen lying around in the office. He's not saying lying around in the office. He's saying float around the office. Why? What's he launching? MacBook Air. Is it sinking in what I'm trying to show you? That he is leaving no stone unturned to position this well. It seems like he is speaking extempore, but he is not speaking extempore. He's come prepared and he's worked hard on this. Now, how many times have we gone back after a debate competition or an elocution or an interview or a date and then felt, if I got a second chance at this, I know exactly what to do better. Have you not felt like that? But the fact is, in life, we don't get second opportunities for first impressions. Let me say that again. In life, we rarely get second opportunities for first impressions. So we need to get the story right the first time around. And that's what he is doing here. You don't get second opportunities to file, you know, supplementary applications at Ivy League colleges. You need to get the story right the first time around. And that's what job. He's not saying, hey, if I got a second chance to launch this, I know exactly. I've learned my lessons. Now next launch, I will get it right. Sometimes when we see guys singing on music reality shows like Indian Idol or Saregama, and we say, ah, oh, this is fantastic. This guy is singing so effortlessly. What we mean by that is he's put in so much effort that today it seems effortless. But behind that word effortless is a full iceberg of effort that is not visible. Let's move forward.
Air. It's so thin, it even fits inside one of these envelopes that we've all seen floating around the office.
So, my question to you, what are they launching? They're launching the thinnest laptop in the world. Maybe the thinnest laptop so far was a Dell laptop, and maybe it was 2 centimeters thick or thin. They have broken that record, and perhaps now they are launching the world's first 1.467 centimeters laptop. Why isn't he going and talking about the data point? He should go and say, this is the world's 1.467. We've broken the 2 centimeters barrier, ladies and gentlemen. And here's a laptop, which is 1.467 centimeters. Why isn't he doing that? Because we forget facts. We remember analogies, similes, and metaphors. Comparison. That's the second technique of a storyteller. You compare it. Suppose you were at the launch. After the launch, you go and meet a friend at a coffee shop. The friend will ask you, where were you? And you would say, I was at the launch of the thinnest laptop in the world. The next question your friend would ask would be, how thin was it? And you wouldn't remember 1.467. You would say it was as thin as an envelope. So comparison is the second technique. Yeah. I had a boss who always used to say, as dash. Now that's a simple method for comparison. As dash. For everything. You know, if I would say it's very affordable, he would say, as affordable as what? Please bring it alive for me. Don't say $5. Say as affordable as a cup of coffee. That will drive home the message. Yeah. If I developed a solution and I said, it's really fast. He said, as fast as what? Don't say 1.3 seconds. Can you see it in human language, like in the blink of an eye or the snap of a finger? That's how humans speak. Yeah, so bring it alive. As dash. As secure as what? As easy as what? Don't we say as easy as child's play? Yeah, comparison, metaphor, analogy, simile. Let's move forward.
It's so thin, it even fits inside one of these envelopes that we've all seen floating around the office. And so let me go ahead and show it to you now.
What's he doing now? He says, let me go ahead and show it to you now. But instead of showing the laptop, he is showing them the envelope. Seeing is believing. He's backing up the story. He could have just said, it's the thinnest laptop. He was the biggest tech guy in the world at that point of time. People would have believed him, but he's not saying, take my word for it. He's giving evidence. He's backing it up with demonstration, with a proof, because seeing is believing. So are you backing up your stories with evidence, with proof, with demonstration? Anchor your story in evidence. Now, evidence is an interesting word. There's a difference between claim and evidence. And I find a lot of stories full of claims. Claims are when you say that this is what it is capable of, or this is what I can do. That's a claim. Give me evidence. Evidence is that which is self-evident. Think about the word itself. What is evidence? It's not evidence if it's not self-evident. If it's not self-evident, it's a claim. That's how I categorize it. So, proof.
This is it. Let me take it out here. This is the new MacBook Air, and you can get a feel for how thin it is. Yeah.
You saw what he did. He took it out. Let me show that to you again.
Air. And you can get a feel for how thin it is.
It took him It took him less than 4 seconds to take the laptop out of the envelope. And then he holds it up in four fingers like you've never held a laptop like this ever before. Why is he holding it like that? And by the way, that's the moment it could have fallen from his hands. And that clip would have gone viral on YouTube, that Steve Jobs drops the laptop at the time of its launch. It doesn't drop. He's practiced that move 100 times. And why did he do that? Because he figured, if I have to show people, I know it is thin, but how will people know it is thin? If I have to show people how thin it is, at what angle should I hold it that it becomes evident to them that it is so thin? Now that's how hard Steve Jobs was working. So I asked you that question just a while back. Do you think storytellers are born storytellers or they are hardworking? Well, a little bit of both. I agree with you. Or let me change that. A little bit of what you're born with and a lot of hard work. Both Anil Ambani and Mukesh Ambani were born with the same things. It's not what we are born with alone, but what we do with what we are born with that also makes a lot of difference. So have you worked hard on your stories? I find that a lot of students are capable and a lot of managers and leaders are capable. You know, when I speak with managers and leaders and organizations, I see that the reality of the work they do, what the actual work they do is really good. But when they have to stand up and tell a story about that work, that story falls short because they are not able to do the truth well told. Similarly, I find that students have a lot of potential. You go and talk to the teacher and the teacher will say, this guy has so much potential. And then when you ask the student to write an essay about their own life story, the story falls short. They use repetitive words. The language is not there. Now look at articulation. Now, you know, articulation is extremely important. Would you agree with me, friends, that, you know, great leaders have good vocabularies? Look around the world, all the names that you mentioned, you know, all good political leaders, Abraham Lincoln, Barack Obama, Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru, that speech that he gave, 1947, tryst, at the stroke of midnight, we have a tryst with destiny. You know, what fantastic vocabulary. So, you know, leaders have better vocabulary than followers. Look at business leaders. All the business leaders, you know, Steve Jobs, Richard Branson, Elon Musk, Indra Nooyi, better vocabulary than the followers. Look at spiritual leaders. They have better vocabulary than the followers. Swami Vivekananda, the speech that he gave that shook up the Western world. You know, the ability to explain something abstract like religion in a way that builds common ground. It's not easy. So vocabulary. Now, let's imagine that, you know, this workshop was happening at a hotel. And if I call up the hotel and I say, you know, he was not describing, you know, Steve Jobs was not describing, you know, something in the language of features. He could have said it's 1.46 centimeters, but he said it's as thin as an envelope. That's the language of benefit. So, you know, not the technology language, but simple language. It's difficult to simplify something. It's easy to complicate. So how do we simplify the benefit language? Let me give an example. If you were doing this at a hotel and I call up a hotel and say, hey, I am calling from KIS. We'd like to book a banquet hall. And this guy picks up the phone from the banquet hall and says, I've got two banquet halls, 60 feet by 70 feet, and another one, which is 40 by 30 feet. Which one shall I book for you? What would I say? Give me a 50 seater. Now, both of us are saying different things, but both of us are right. He was speaking the accurate language, but the language of features. We need to convert that to the language of benefit. What's in it for the other person? How do I simplify? Now, articulation is a key skill. Vocabulary is required for that. I fear for, you know, let me just, you know, in closing, just say this, that build your vocabulary if you want to be a good storyteller, particularly metaphorical vocabulary, because The well-told requires that. You know, it could be visual vocabulary, oral vocabulary. You know, musicians have a vocabulary of sound, but you know, we, you know, artists have a deftness and vocabulary of another kind. But you need to be able to build vocabulary. Now, my heart goes out to those kids who, to everything that you ask them, you know, how was this experience? They have one word answer: awesome. So you ask them, hey, how was that birthday party? You went to McDonald's, you had French fries and burger. How was that? Awesome. All right. My next question to you. You went to Disneyland. You went to Universal Studios. You went on that roller coaster. How was that for you? Awesome. So everything is awesome. Now, you know, if you repeat the words again and again, eventually when you want to use that word, it would have lost its power. So it loses its power because, you know, economies of scale will kick in, and you know, not economy, but, you know, something called diminishing returns. So diminishing returns is a concept in economics which says when you use something more and more often, it loses its power. So next time I come to you and say, hey, how was that movie? You saw Lion King in 3D. How was it? Awesome. Okay. How was your first sleepover, your first pajama party? Awesome. And my heart goes out to this kid because one day this kid will grow up, will fall in love, will hold someone's hand, will hug someone, will feel emotions and sensations in mind and body and soul never felt before. What will she come back and say? Awesome. So through this example, I hope I have demonstrated to you that it's not just what we say, but also how we say it. Let me pause here. One can go on and on, but I think it's a good place for me to pause. And it was really wonderful to share a little bit with you about what I have understood of our own story, that we all have stories to tell, but we live in an attention deficit world. We live in a world cluttered with too much information, and it is our job to tell our story well. When you write that application, the person has not seen you, but they need to be able to see your soul and a potential. And there's an old jungle saying in Africa, if the lion doesn't tell its own story well, the hunter does. That's a great note for me to end. You're the lion, take charge of your story. Now, if you have questions, I'd love to take them. But if you have none, I am all the more happier.
Thank you so much, Amin. Thank you so much for sharing that wonderful talk. I think it was filled with examples of how we can analyze our own, you know, stories, how you can analyze somebody else when they're speaking. It was very practical. And thank you so much for sharing those tips. I do see a question on the window, so I'm going to raise that. There's a person who says, I have a great vocabulary, but I can't tell a story.
Oh, yeah. That's a perfect question. And I'm glad someone asked that. It's not the only thing. Vocabulary isn't the only thing. Because, you know, the idea. So what's a good vocabulary? The idea of a vocabulary is not to have a vocabulary like Shashi Tharoor, where I have to look up a dictionary when somebody starts speaking. If I have to look up a dictionary, then I will not be focusing on you. A great vocabulary isn't enough. It's only a tool. It's a means to an end. Of course. As Javed Akhtar says, and to me, a good example is Javed Akhtar, who has great vocabulary. You know, the lyricist, Farhan Akhtar's father, you know, he has such wonderful vocabulary that he doesn't complicate, he simplifies. The test of good vocabulary is to be able to simplify something so that one can understand that. Like, take an idea like love. In Hindi films, in Bollywood films, every movie has a song about love. How many different ways can one express that idea? But Javed Akhtar, he's done it again and again and again with freshness and with simplicity. In fact, one of my favorite songs is from a movie called 1942, A Love Story, where he talks about love and falling in love with the ordinariness of a conversation. It almost feels like two guys are standing outside a shop and having a conversation and saying, "Ek ladki ko dekha to aisa laga." You know, this is what I felt when I saw a girl. Now it's almost conversational. The test of good vocabulary is to simplify, not complicate, and then connect with heart, connect with emotions. So vocabulary is a means to an end, but not the end by itself. I'm so glad you asked that question and allowed me to elaborate upon it. Otherwise, we would have just focused on vocabulary and not all the other elements that come in and make a story a good story.
Thanks, Amin. There's another question. How can one improve the skills of storytelling and make it second nature?
Much like you learn cycling, much like you learn swimming, and much like you learn walking. Now, remember the days when you learned cycling? Go back in time if you can. And when you were cycling, when you were learning how to cycle, your hands, your eyes were not on the road. Your eyes were firmly on your hands. And you were seeing, am I turning my hands this way, that way? Today, you don't have to do that. It's become second nature. It's almost like walking. See, if I'm walking and I see someone coming by, I don't have to calculate to avoid this person, should I turn 30 degrees or 40 degrees? We automatically, second nature, we automatically turn to avoid each other without calculating. But when I was learning, I was bumping into things all the time. The same is true with swimming. So how does it become second nature? With practice, with deliberate practice. And with deliberate practice comes reflection. Reflection is key because just practice is not enough. You know, Malcolm Gladwell has written a book which has made something famous, 10,000 hour rule, that if you practice something for 10,000 hours, you become good. Well, that's not entirely true. What he meant was if you practice and reflect on something, then otherwise, then you become better at it. Otherwise, the taxi drivers in Mumbai would be the best car drivers in the world because they do tick the 10,000 hour rule. Instead, if I drive and say, hey, yesterday I was not in a good mood. What kind of music was I listening to? What if I change the music? Does it increase my happiness? Now that's reflection. So practice combined with reflection. Now, how to practice? Well, there are multiple ways to improve storytelling by practice. I'll give a simple tip. Increasingly today, we are tasked with telling stories very quickly. And people have low attention spans. So they say, hey, can you tell your story very quickly? One of the ways to build that ability is to, you know, I say there are super short stories or micro fiction or terribly tiny tales. Just look them up on Instagram, on Facebook, on Google Images, and you'll find microfiction, super short stories, or terribly tiny tales. These are places where people tell a story very quickly. Now, you start looking them up one a day and then start writing your own. One of the shortest short stories ever is attributed to, I'm not sure if it is written by, but is attributed to Ernest Hemingway. And let me type it out on the chat window. That story is for sale, comma, baby shoes, comma, I think never worn or never used. Now that's the story. Six words, for sale, baby shoes, never used. Now, why are they for sale? Why were they never used? What happened to the baby? It's all left for the reader's imagination. And a good story is where this interplay happens, where I bring in the reader to fill in the blanks. And that's a good story where you bring in the reader to fill in the blanks. If the teller has to do all the work. So practice writing super short stories. That's one way. The other thing that you can do to improve your storytelling is, remember this, all stories are transportation devices. I'll say this again. All stories are transportation devices. So they have to transport the audience. Where? To your perspective, to see things the way you see it. So to tell a story, the second thing you can do is anchor it in place and anchor it in time. When did this take place? Where did this take place? So if I say, you know, hey, I was in Gujarat on 26 January 2018 and. So I'm taking you out of present context. I'm taking you out of Kodaikanal to Gujarat and to 2018. And that's how good stories begin, by anchoring it. So, you know, that's the second thing. The third thing that, you know, that will make you good when you practice this is to paint a picture. To paint a picture for the listener or for the reader. So when you paint a picture, describe a character. Don't just say John. The hero of the story is John. How old is John? Is he rich and poor? What are the circumstances? Paint a picture. And when you paint a picture, use the five senses or four or three. Use as many senses. So bring in, what is the soundscape? What is the texture of that place? What are the smells of that place? What do you see? You know, when you see John and John's surroundings, describe the surroundings so that the audience can see what's happening there. Let me give you a simple example to illustrate this. I'm going to tell a story. Say in this story, there is a character called Rahul. Rahul feels tormented and tortured at home because mother keeps feeding or dad keeps feeding all the good food like milk, paneer, ghee, butter, palak, okra. And, you know, he hates all of this. So, you know, they are of course doing it out of love, but he hates all of this. So one day he throws the plate on the ground and says, I am running away from home. Nobody likes me in this home. And with tears rolling down his cheeks, he ran towards the forest. And he ran towards the forest, which was close to his house. He was told, never go into the forest. There are dangerous animals. But today he wasn't thinking. He was just running. And he ran and ran till his tears dried. And then he paused and looked around. And the forest was so dense. It was daytime. But it was so dense that it was dark inside the forest. Now he paused. And he could hear the sounds of birds and animals. Then he heard the sound of approaching animals. And then some of them were not friendly. They were growls. And now he was scared. So he turned around to go back. But he couldn't find a path. He didn't remember where he came from. Should he go to the right or the left? Now he turned around all the way 180 degrees, but the more he turned, the more he lost the way. He took one step and a dry leaf cracked under his foot. That sound startled him, but he also got scared, thinking that now the sound will attract the animals. He stood there frozen. Now my question to you, let's play rapid fire. Rapid fire, I want your hands on your keyboard. How old was Rahul? Quickly, I didn't describe it, but in your imagination, how old was Rahul? I want to see answers quickly. How old was Rahul for you? For you, for you. That's the key question. Yeah, 10 years. Okay, fantastic. What was he wearing? Yeah, no idea. Maybe 30. No, he was a kid. He was a kid because his parents were there, but you know, he can still be a kid to his parents. So he could be 30. Yeah, fantastic. What was he wearing when he was shorts and tee and shoes? Or was he running barefoot? Yeah. And did you see the forest? And did you see the animals? What animals did you see in the forest? You know, I described some animals and he saw some animals approaching and some of them were scary sounds. So what were? A bear and a lion. And for somebody else, it could be a tiger and a cheetah or something else. You see, here's the point. When I was telling you the story, I was not the only one who was working hard. You were all filling in the blanks. You were imagining Rahul. You were imagining the forest. And you were imagining the animals. And by the way, the animals you saw are unique to you. The animals somebody else saw are unique to them. And that's why, you know, reading, you know, painting a picture. That's what I was doing. I was painting a picture. So that's how you paint a picture. By the way, you know, let me say this in conclusion. Reading and telling a story is the best way to foster someone's imagination and strengthen someone's imagination. Because if you were seeing the story on television, all of you would see the same Rahul, the same forest, and the same animals. There is less to imagine there. But when you read a story, you fill in the blanks. So read a lot and you will be a good storyteller. It fosters and strengthens your imagination. I think that's a good place for me to pause.
Thank you so much, Amin. That was really wonderful. I particularly enjoyed this whole session. I think it felt like being in front of a screen and seeing some visuals, although there were no visuals and it was just you speaking, but the way in which you invoked the sounds, they invoked the scenery, it was really very pleasing and visually appealing. In some ways, I also started retrospecting about, you know, I've been conducting these Parent Week events and I've been introducing a lot of people, and perhaps there's a lot more that I could do in terms of preparation, which could mean, you know, just sitting down, reflecting what is my objective when I do this 2-minute intro session, and crafting my words and thinking using the tips that you've given. So thank you so much. It was a really enlightening session. Thanks again. For all the audience, I hope you enjoyed the session. Amin, it was a pleasure having you with us at KIS. I hope you have the chance to visit Kodi sometime, and we would love to host you here. Thank you once again. Have a wonderful evening. See ya.